Warning: Critique Revolve contains adult language and discussions. If you're easily offended, do not continue to listen. Hello. Hello and welcome to Critique Revolve. My name is Michael Flores, and you're listening to the Rain Man Digital Network. I'm all alone today in the studio. Hopefully, I can give you enough information on this film that I went to go see this past week that you'll enjoy it and possibly go see the movie. I'll let you decide for yourself by the time this review is over. Now, the film that I went to see this past week is titled Mr. Turner and is directed and written by Mike Leigh. Now, Mr. Turner is a 2014 British, French, and German biographical drama film written and directed by Mike Leigh and starring Timothy Spall. The film concerns the life and career of British artist J.M.W. Turner, played by Spall, premiered in competition for the Palme d'Or at the 2014 Cannes Film Festival, where Spall won the award Best Actor and cinematographer Dick Pope received special jury prize for the film's cinematography. Now, that alone right there, okay, I'll tell you right now, Spall was brilliant on screen, and Dick Pope, the cinematographer, brilliant scenes. And those are the exact, I wasn't aware that they actually won those two awards until after coming back from seeing the review and gathering my show notes. But if I had to choose two elements to be nominated, those would be the two elements, was the performance by Spall, and then, of course, the cinematography by Pope, which Pope, I'm going to get into him a little bit more, but he's actually has done the cinematography for a couple of my favorite films. And I knew I recognized the style as soon as they faded in. I immediately knew it was somebody I was familiar with his work. Now Leigh has described Turner as a great artist, a radical, a revolutionary painter, explaining, "I felt there was a scope for a film examining the tension between the very mortal, flawed individual and the epic work, the spiritual way he had of distilling the world." And I mean, Mike Leigh said, say what you want. There has been a few naysayers about the writing and about the pacing of the film. Some have said it was dull. And it isn't like yippee-yay-ki-yay exciting by any means. But it's a story of a man's life that was interesting if you're watching it for just the quirkiness of Spall's performance. That alone it magnetizes you enough to keep those eyes planted on the screen and really watch how the story unfolds. Now, my initial reaction when I saw this was director Mike Leigh paints a gorgeous and vibrant retelling of the odd life of the eccentric British painter J.M.W. Turner. Those are my own words. That's what I sent in to our PR company after seeing this film. And I stand by those words. I'm not one of those people that I don't want to blast a movie, and I don't want to, blow a movie either unless it deserves it. And there were some flaws in this film. As I said, the writing was a bit murky. The script was not the best. It was very hard. As people know me, I really pick apart the scripts of things. And the first act was wonky. I don't really know where it ended and where the second began. I definitely saw the second act break leading to the third for sure. But for the most part, I felt like it kind of all jumbled together, and there were some scene issues as well. For example, there's a lot of cutting. He travels. Mr. Turner travels the world. Much like a lot of artists yearn to do, they want to see things. And he's a landscape painter. This is what Mr. Turner was. So he goes and travels. That's what he does. He goes and travels by boat to across the sea to other lands. He goes to other countries and walks. He walks for miles and he paints what he sees. He sketches what he sees. So he's much like artists of today, you know, except he was very eccentric in some aspects, which we're going to get into as well. But I think that was probably one of the more negative things about the film is they were just a bit jumpy. You would be in one scene and then suddenly you'd be in the next scene. For example, he had a mistress or a lover in one city, and he would be living at his home with his housemaid and his father. And his housemaid, he had some odd sexual relationship with of sorts. It felt like she loved him, but he didn't really return the favor, but he still would have sex with her. So he had kind of like a double life, and you would be seeing one. You'd see him at his home, his real home, with his father and his maid or a house servant, whatever you want to call her. And then all of a sudden, within about 2 seconds, you'll be immediately at his, you know, mistress's home or his lover's home. And that just threw me out every single time. It took me almost, again, the running time on this movie is 150 minutes. It took me probably 80 minutes to get adjusted to that. Finally, it didn't throw me off. But every time they did it, they just threw you off. Now, not to say it was any, they did set it up that way. The writing did adjust, meaning when they first took you to those scenes, they showed him go to those scenes. They showed Spall or Turner get on the boat, travel to this other city where his girlfriend lived. So it did show you that. But after they showed him travel to these unique spots, they never once again showed him traveling necessarily. It would just, boom, he's there. And I know they needed to save time. They can't show you traveling each time. I just think the way it was laid out in editing, it would throw you. It kind of was jolting, and it took you a minute to kind of get used to where you were, to get acclimated to where you were now at. But that was the only big issue I thought with the film. Other than that, a little bit on the acting. Despite the fact-based character, this is from an article that I found online. Despite the fact-based characters, Mr. Turner, this is from the Variety, Mr. Turner was developed the same improvisational workshop process as all of Lee's films. Now, this is what I thought was really interesting, and the results have been acutely researched and had a lived-in feel. That's especially true of Spall, who so fully internalizes Turner that he doesn't seem to be playing the part as much as channeling it. It was very much that. It was very much Daniel Day-Lewis type channeling, where he wasn't just, because you have these different actors. You have actors that portray a part, and then you have actors who are the part. And this guy, I for a while, and I'll be honest, because Spall is actually from, I would say, from a mainstream aspect. He's most known from his Harry Potter part, where he played Peter Pettigrew, I believe how you say his name, which was, I think I want to say his name was, he was the rat guy, I want to say, at one point. Wormtail, I think. He was a bad guy. Very noticeable. I would even call him, at this point, until this film, I'd even call him a character actor of sorts. And it took me about 10 minutes to, like, separate that when watching him on screen, which is pretty fast. 10 minutes of this image of this guy who played this character in Harry Potter, and he was in a couple of Tim Burton's films as well. He plays usually the same guy, kind of awkwardly squished-looking face. And it took me about 10 minutes of watching him on film, and it immediately, I no longer viewed him as that character. I viewed him as Mr. Turner. That's how good of a job Timothy did with this role. Let's see here. Also, it says here, this is especially true, Spall, who so fully, going back to this article, who so fully internalizes Turner, seems like he's channeling it more than playing the role. With his great squashed-in face, Spall shows you every flicker of thought that flashes across Turner's mind. And indeed, he did. I mean, phenomenal. His mannerisms, the way he looked at you, there's scenes that they set up. And this is what you do with actors like that. And this, I love it. Like, I guarantee you, Mike Leigh just sat down, wrote some lines, and said, listen, you know what? This whole scene is just going to be written so that Timothy can perform to these other actors that we're going to throw in front of you. He didn't hide his dislikes of certain people. And he would just give you this face. And when he was trying to portray something without saying words, he would grunt. I mean, grunting, come on, you don't want to really want to grunt your whole way through a film, and yet his grunts of just disgruntlement was fascinating. How he turned in something that was unintelligible, and he made it work on screen and made it part of this character. It makes me curious as to whether or not it makes me want to pick up a book, even though I do know a little bit about Turner. It makes me want to pick up a book and find out a little bit more about this person. Like, is there something written down that he grunted at people? Was there something written down that he would just look at you with judgmental eyes and kind of weigh you? Like, who are you? So now from an interview with Spall, he says, talk about suffering from your art, achieving his acclaimed performance as the masterful British landscape painter J.M.W. Turner. And Mr. Turner took so much out of Timothy Spall, the veteran actor found himself kneeling down at the artist's tomb in St. Paul's Cathedral when it was all over, and he said he was crying. I just knelt down, he says, had a bit of a weep, and I wiped it all off on my elbow. The 57-year-old actor says, it was quite a journey, you know. Again, another example of how this actor threw himself in it, and he definitely deserved any awards that he was given. Now, another thing, briefly, is the way the cinematography was, and I was trying to find the words, and I have scribble marks. It's very hard to write in a theater that's pitch black, and you can't have electronic equipment where you can write on my iPad. Normally, that's what I'd like to do. But the cinematography, Dick Pope did a fantastic job. The way they captured these scenes. Okay, the way the film opened, let's start with that. The film opens up on a scene that had to be about a five-minute take. Maybe 4 minutes, 3 to 5. Let's say 3 to 5 minute take. It shows two ladies working in the fields, and they're walking towards camera having a conversation. And it takes a good 3 minutes during the credits to get to us. And then the camera pans left, and Spall is over the hill in silhouette, sketching the ocean below him. Just a gorgeous scene. And the way Dick Pope captures, starting with the very opening scene, and it goes throughout the rest of the film, he manages to paint a picture himself. And many of his captured shots look like a J.M.W. Turner painting. That's awesome. I mean, that would be remiss, in my opinion, if you didn't do that. If you just said, I'm going to go with whatever camera style I usually do, and never mind what the film's about. That is the mark of a good cinematographer. You take the meat of the story. You take the heart and what the film is about, and you use that to basically work your art, and you take your craft and you then work around that and cut it around to where it could feel like it belongs in this movie. And I mean, it's stunning. After the film review, or after I saw the film, I went and looked up a bunch of paintings, which many of his paintings were actually in this film, but I went and looked online because I really wanted to find out, and I compared some of these screenshots that has been released for press, and I just compared them, Dick Pope's cinematography with JMW's Turner, and he just did a fantastic job capturing the original artwork, and it looked like a painting coming to life. It was just completely gorgeous. So if you're really into the art side of film, I highly suggest you watching this. Never mind, the writing wasn't bad, as I said. There's some issues, but if you can just watch it for Spall's performance, you watch it for the cinematography and the sheer artistic value that went into this film, I guarantee you'll find yourself enjoying the movie. Now, I don't want to forget, before we end this review today, I don't want to forget about the production. Top-notch tech credits definitely has to be extended to the production designer, Susie Davies, and the costume designer, Jacqueline Duran, who make their own invaluable contributions to bringing the film's 19th century world to life, vividly to life. And of course, the composer, Gary Yershon's original score. I mean, mind-blowing composing. His score, again, did much what Dick Pope did for the cinematography. Gary's score aided in giving you the right mood, the right atmosphere. Everything worked so well together, from production design to score to performance, and of course cinematography. Everything just worked together to give you the true vibe and essence and feel that Mike Leigh wanted the audience to have. And I felt they accomplished that. It was a gorgeous film. Once again, there are some dull points. The movie is 150 minutes, so that's a little over 2 hours. So the movie does drag in areas, but I think there's plenty of fun little moments in this film that people can take and really enjoy. There was, before we end, there were a few favorite scenes here. There was a scene with the camera where Turner is being fitted for a photo shoot, which, again, this is, 18th century, I believe. Is that what I said? This is in the 1700s, late 1800s or early 1800s. And he's getting this camera is obviously a new device. And I loved his conversation that he had with the cameraman, which if you see this, I think any film buff would absolutely love it because it shows the connection between paintings. So the whole way that their conversation they had together was brilliant. I guess was this the synergy between camera and painter and how well it works together and where the inspirations really derive from when it comes to cinematography. But also it kind of has a little competitive scene as well where you find that Mr. Turner actually is upset about these cameras and he discusses with the cameraman, like, where is he going to go? Where is he shot at before? And he said, well, I plan on going to the Niagara Falls, or I shot at the Niagara Falls before. And you can see the jealousy in his face because he's never been able to paint that. And he makes this comment where, wow, I can see in a matter of years, people will be not carrying canvases anymore or brushes, and they're just going to be carrying this camera around taking pictures, showing that how the art form is going to change drastically in the near future, where people are going to stop painting as much and they're going to move over to the preferred medium of today, which is the camera to this day. It just reminded me of the battle between film and digital, and that's kind of why I liked it. I don't know if Mike Leigh was doing that intentionally or not, but I saw the similarities and the parallels between the two different versions, camera versus painting, and then of course digital versus film. There's some very awkward sexual scenes as well, and some people, I mean, there was only half a dozen people in the screening. It was early in the morning, and it just the discomfort when the sex scenes would pop up was funny. I liked seeing people's reactions, but. And they were very awkward scenes of sex. It wasn't just the typical things that people have kind of seen since the 80s where, you sit down in bed and you make love. These scenes were truly awkward. And I really appreciate them from a realistic standpoint because let's be honest, sex is awkward and it's never like it is in TV shows that they make them out to be so perfect, how they're done so perfectly and everything comes out planned how you think it should come out. But the way it was done on camera, it was very awkward, a little perverse. But again, if you were to take yourself out of it, let's say you're having sex and you take yourself out for a moment, be that fly on the wall, I guarantee you, you'd feel the same way because sex is just awkward. And that's why I love the realness of these scenes. I'm going to go ahead and conclude with today's Critique Revolve. Hopefully, I will be back. I'll be back, I think, next week with Andrew Spindler, one of the new reviewers on our network, for another Critique Revolve, where we'll be talking about Michael Mann's latest film, Black Hat. And then, of course, I think the week after that, me and Greg will be doing a retro review of The Hobbit, and we're going to be talking about the high frame rate and the whole entire visual effects side of things. So look forward to that. I hope you enjoyed today's Critique Revolve. Thank you, and good day.
The Corova Milk Bar sold Milk Plus. Milk Plus Velocet, or Synthomesque, or Drencrum, which is what we were drinking. This would sharpen you up and make you ready for a bit of the old ultraviolence.